This is Tim.
Lily.
And Patrick.
This is Deconstructing Comics.
That'd be the other Patrick.
Right. No, this is the original Patrick, and the other Patrick is the other Patrick.
I got it.
Welcome to Deconstructing Comics, sponsored by ComicsNow.com. We've found a fairly quiet place to record this time.
Yeah.
And I brought up as a topic that in the interviews that we've had on the podcast recently, a couple times the idea has come up of Matt Cillity was talking about Perry Bible Fellowship, that it's been a webcomic for a while, and then... You know, it was, of course, free on the web, but then Dark Horse came out with a printed version of it, and it was selling like hotcakes, I guess, according to him.
That makes sense. Perry Bible Fellowship has managed... It's one of the webcomics that's managed to hang on for a number of years, and it's accumulated a pretty heavy fan base. I was introduced to it before I came to Japan, so you're looking at probably 3 years ago now? And, you know, my friend had been a fan of it long before that.
It's a weird strip because he...
It's very dark.
What's the guy's name? Do you know?
No clue.
Maybe next time we can do some research, but before we start recording.
That would require actually spending time on things before the podcast.
I'll link to it from the podcast page, globalcomics.net. But, yeah, I mean, he does several different styles, and you're like, is this the same guy doing every strip? But I guess it actually is.
It's got a really dark tone, right? Like a very...
Well, but even the ones ironic, that look like, you know, more bright or humorous ones are really still have the dark undertone to the joke.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. So there was that, and then there was also in the... interview with Chris Staros from Top Shelf. He talked about Super Spy, which Brandon and I reviewed a few months ago. That was originally published on the web, and he had pointed out, and I hadn't even really noticed it, that the pages are mostly just like it's like three rows on almost every page, three rows of panels. So it was that because it was originally published in strips on the site, and then later they put it together into pages in a way that doesn't feel like, you know, it's just rows of strips somehow. Mm. And there are some alterations to the pattern here and there. But so I was just thinking about the whole raging controversy about online distribution of things and whether they should go out for free, but, whether it's giving away the store to put things up for free on the net. Or if that will lead to more sales later. And of course, it's a hot topic in music and movies and so forth. And I actually read something in Spin not too long ago. Well, I'm way further behind on reading Spin than I am on reading my comics, but there was a story about how almost inevitably these days albums get leaked out before their official release date. But some people were in the music business are quoted as saying, like, you should never prevent people from hearing your music. You know, and, you know, all the legal restrictions and copying restrictions on the files and so forth that are going on.
Yeah, there's a big movement for removing DRM from these things. And I know Steve Jobs had his big thing. Right, because, yeah, I mean, you can remove it anyway.
Some of the stuff on iTunes, I know they're selling without copy protection.
And it's kind of interesting, because you had Steve Jobs of Apple and iTunes came out with his big public letter saying that we really, you know, we'd love to sell everything without DRM, without the copy protection on it. And then, which was it, EMI?
I think that's right.
EMI was the first. And now... they're actually in order to try and loosen iTunes' grip on the download music market. You have Amazon, which offers only DRM, and the companies that require Apple, the rest of the basically all of the music companies except EMI, which require Apple and iTunes to use DRM, are selling their music without the copy protection through Amazon.
Mm. So it's without everything through Amazon without DRM.
Right, without DRM.
One other thing I noticed, though, was when Apple suddenly put out DRM, the price point was higher than the other songs. They're no longer 99 cents or like $1.89 or something like that.
Right, right. That's changed back.
Because Amazon was underselling them.
Right.
I don't know exactly if that was record companies that were demanding more, or Apple just doing their kind of thing. But Apple's been pretty good about keeping the price points pretty low.
Mm.
In fact, they've been fighting with a lot of companies over that. And mm-hmm. the idea of them raising it on their end is seems unrealistic to me. Basically, one thing I've been noticing with the whole illegal download thing, which I don't know too much about, but you know, I have my sources, is that people have been releasing their material on the web themselves as testers.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the Sarah Connor Chronicles for Terminator, the TV show, was released a good couple of months. The pilot was released a good couple of months before, same as Eli Stone and a couple other shows, and some shows that were pilots but never got picked up.
Mm.
What did they call them?
Pilots.
Pilots. Yeah.
Just failed pilots? Pilots.
All right. Even failed pilots now are beginning to work their way onto the web.
See if at least someone. Audience.
Yeah, and it becomes a portfolio piece at that point. Someone will see it, they like the actors, there's a good response, the download hit rate is pretty high. They know that something about that was good. Maybe it'll give someone a chance to work later. Maybe it's their way of testing without officially releasing.
Yeah, to see how something will actually do in the wild.
Exactly. And another one would be Michael Moore, who released his documentary Sicko to the public, although he doesn't admit it publicly, as a safety measure against the U.S. blocking his film.
Hmm.
There was all kinds of, we're going to confiscate it when it comes in, or we're going to take your film. So he had it hidden in locations around the world, copies of it hidden. And then suddenly it was available online. Everybody could get it.
Hmm.
And
see, I never heard of any of this.
Yeah, no, it was a bit of a news piece because there was so much back and forth between the government and Michael Moore, that it got picked up as a news story, and then suddenly it was everywhere on the web, and everybody saw it, except me, of course, because I went to the movie theater and paid my $1,800 yet. I don't know, do anything illegal.
No, not at all.
Yeah, so anyway, so there are a lot of reasons why you might want to put it up for free. In fact, going back to comics, Dark Horse Comics released War of the Worlds, an awesome, awesome version, which makes the Steven Spielberg, Tom Cruise adaptation look pitiful.
Hmm.
And this is just a comic, just in air quotes, because, you know, I'm a comic guy.
Well, we know comics rule, but...
Yeah, yeah, no, of course, that goes without saying.
Yeah.
But the fact that... a couple of comic guys can outstrip Tom Cruise and Steven Spielberg, people who are supposed to be at the top of their game.
Mm. On the other hand, it makes sense that it would be better because, you know, you don't have budgetary restrictions.
Better in design, better in scripting, and when it comes down to it...
And you don't have to sell it to the lowest common denominator for the summer blockbuster.
I think we're not talking budget restrictions with Spielberg and Cruise.
Mm, that's a good point.
basically, between the imagination of the comic creator and the imagination... Because we're not actually building hard models of things. We're not building city miniatures. Mm-hmm. It's all on a computer.
Mm.
That's how Battlestar Galactica and Babylon 5... who used the same special effects guy, got their shit done.
Hmm.
They kept the special effects down to a minimum, but it was just always a guy on a computer.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. One guy on a computer.
Really?
Yeah. For Babylon 5, it's definitely so, but...
well, you can tell that sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah, but you want a spaceship, there's a spaceship. Never mind the fact that the control room was just a guy holding on to some like stick stuck on the floor with a curtain behind him.
But, an Atari joystick or something like that.
Yeah, it was pretty bad at times. But that stuff aside...
So you think that the War of the Worlds comic was better than the movie just in terms of the imagination of the creator?
The imagination of the... well, it's an adaptation, of course.
But well, yeah, I mean, I don't mean H.G. Wells, but the person who did the comic had better imagination than Steven Spielberg.
I think he tried to stick to the source material a little closer. I've not read the original, so I don't know for sure, but it was a period piece, and it took place in England.
Mm.
And it was...
That would be closer to
jaw-droppingly awe-inspiring goodness. Mm. And the amount of shit that this guy goes through in the story is incredible. Whereas Tom Cruise, yeah, he'll work it out in the end. But at the end of the movie, sorry, spoiler alert, when Tom Cruise's kid, who went over the hill in a blaze of fire, shows up at the end, it's like, what... What the fuck is this?
Yeah, that was the moment that I got up and
laughed. Yeah,
like, well, and I'm done.
Yeah, exactly. But unfortunately, the film was done too, so they got you.
So it could just be that the comic was better because it stuck closer to the original.
That very well could have been, but the designs were better.
Mm-hmm.
And with most comic book guys, we're talking about one guy in a room thinking up what would be cool.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Rather than a team of guys following a director who has years of experience.
Mm-hmm. And then having all the good ideas come out, cut out by some producer. And
right, exactly.
It's Spielberg. He's not going to get usurped by anybody.
Mm.
This is the top director in Hollywood.
Is he the one cutting out all the good ideas?
Possibly. Maybe we're looking at the end of his good game. But basically, what I mean to say is we have a fantastic comic that was released on the web and released as a book for sale, I think simultaneously.
Mm.
Almost simultaneously. I think they released it in stages.
Mm-hmm.
I found out about the book because it was on drawn.ca. Mm-hmm. They had a preview or just a little picture and say, hey, this is up for free over at Dark Horse. I went over, and they had released it in segments on the web, but it was completely there now. And the final comic book was for sale.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know exactly what their numbers were or how their sales went, but it looked so good on screen that I wanted to buy a copy, but I'm not a man of money, so there you go.
Hmm. But you had the option of reading it on the screen.
Yeah, and I clicked through every page. I just couldn't. Mm-hmm. I could not turn away.
Huh.
Which brings us to the main point here, which is if something is available online, would you pay for it in a paper form, in a hard copy form?
If I have the money, I would. Mm. But if I don't have the money, which I don't,
mm-hmm.
Available online or not, I'm not going to buy it.
Right.
So it now tells me that there's a cool writer and a cool comic artist out there making really good work that I want to follow.
Mm-hmm.
It also tells me that I can go back to Dark Horse or whatever comic site and read more comics in the future.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And Top Shelf is planning to do the same thing more and more, Chris Darrow's told me.
Putting things online.
Online, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hmm. It's interesting. And if you look out at all, you know, all the people who are doing sort of their own independent comics, they're basically doing the same thing. That they're putting it out available for free, but then they're also collecting it into a book. And I think pretty much everybody who's doing web comics in some way is doing this. I know that... what is it? Kukuburi?
Yeah.
Is doing that.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. Well, he's planning on putting out a book. He's looking into it, and he might go with Lulu or some of the other ways of doing it, but...
Yeah.
Hopefully he'll have enough of a following that he'll be able to actually print it for a traditional publisher, traditional printer, which is usually, for a book, a better bet. Mm. But if you can't sell... if you can't sell 1,000 copies, at least... then you can't really do it through a traditional publisher.
Right.
Well, and I know the guy who does Rice Boy is using Lulu, too. I don't see how he can't get a real publisher, though.
I don't know. I'm not really sure good. How... yeah, it's excellent.
Mm-hmm.
He might not want to get a traditional publisher.
Mm. Yeah, but I mean,
but
I would think you'd be able to sell 1,000 copies.
You
so.
See, that's what I would think too. So I'm not sure. Maybe it's too hard to color correct for regular books, or he doesn't have the time. I don't know
what his deal is. Mm. His mysterious Rice Boy creator, but
I tried to get an interview with him, and I couldn't get a response out of him. He's afraid to face me. He's afraid to come on the Factor.
Yeah, like, the Factor.
Jeez.
The one thing about Lulu is they're a great service as a tester for different markets.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever you make up, at the end of the day, on the back or somewhere in it, it's going to have Lulu.com
right.
stamped on it.
Yep.
And I really don't want that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to place a commercial for their product piggybacked on my product
right.
when the price that they're offering is not that good.
Mm-hmm. No.
In fact, there's no money to be made through Lulu.
Yeah, it's really difficult to make any kind of... I mean, yeah. you'll sell something for $20 and make $3 to $5 off of it, which
and
is just wrong.
If you have the following to actually make a profit off of Lulu... I mean, to make serious money off of Lulu, you've got enough of a following to go without Lulu and make an even larger profit.
Exactly.
So, really, there's no point to them.
Well, I mean, they're good for people who are testing to see if they have a market.
Yeah. Oh, testers, that's it.
Right. But, and they're also good for people who have a small, who have a very small following.
And people are willing to fork over, you know, Lulu's fee on top of what the creator's making.
Exactly.
Which really... I looked at, like, Rice Boy book prices, like, geez,
really? $30 to $40 for the book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jeez.
But for a full color, that's what you're going to... For a full color
true,
book, that's what you're
color.
Going to get through
mm-hmm.
Lulu.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm doing a calendar through Lulu now, and I'm charging... because it's past the first of the year, I dropped the price down pretty much as low as I can and still earn a little money off of it. And it's still $16 for a calendar, which is, you know, $16 to $20, which, you know, when you're in Japan, that's nothing. But if you were in the U.S., calendars usually go for about $13 on the newsstand. Some of them more, some of them less. And, of course, after the first of the year, they usually go for half of that, 50%
right.
off.
Right.
So, but I also looked into printing it myself.
Mm.
Now... If you're doing a book or something, yeah, you're going to have boxes of it lying around, but books never go out. A calendar, something like a calendar, you know, after the first of the year, it's going to be a hell of a lot harder to move.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's no way that, you know, unless I have a following of at least 500 to 1,000 people that I know are going to pick it up, there's just no way that I can afford to, you know, to suck it up and print something like that.
But I think a lot of people are hitting cons and trying to sell their stuff there, going on kind of book tours, even for comic book artists,
right.
Where you're going shop to shop. Mm-hmm. And even if they're not going to give you a couple hours of store time to just sit and meet fans and a little bit of publicity, they'll consider, and I know there are some shops that will basically give you a little bit of shelf space for your book.
Right.
I know several in Los Angeles, and I know a couple in San Francisco that will do that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of these days, when I finally produce something, I will be looking at doing that.
The cons are an interesting thing, because I do know, I come from more of a fine arts and illustration background than comic, and that was in air quotes.
Yeah, mine was also kind of an air quote.
And so I'm, you know, I've never done the Comic-Con thing. I mean, I've been to a few, but I've never tried, you know, done a desk at one. But I do know that you've got similar things in the non-comic art world where you've got fairs and, I don't know, flea markets and stuff like that, which people go to and they push their prints and their things that way. So it's similar, and I do know people who travel around the country doing these... doing cons and doing flea markets to sell their work, and I, you know, it's successful to an extent, I suppose.
As far as the online comics, I think, well, one impetus to buy the book would be that a lot of times, I think, especially with the publishers, they only put it up for a limited time.
Mm.
You know, like Super Spy isn't still on Top Shelf's website,
really?
But I don't think. Mm. But you can buy the book. When I talked to Mulele about this on the phone before, you mentioned also the niceness of being able to hold the paper in your hand and not have to read it on the screen.
There is something very nice and tactile about having a book in your hand when you're reading it. And
you can carry it around, look at it anywhere.
You can sit on a sofa and read it rather than, you know, having to be looking at a monitor. You have a hot laptop on your lap or, you know, something like that. And then there's also something kind of nice about being able to actually turn a page and have it all there rather than click a button and wait for the next page to upload and click a button and wait for the next page to upload. It flows a lot better in paper form than it does on the computer.
Yeah, that's true. But also, I'm a fan of packaging. I really like packaging. And if I ever come out with a product that I had absolute control over, including, like, you know, deciding how much I actually want to spend rather than what I can afford, you'll see how much
your
I like packaging. See, I just didn't know what to do. Get of the shit.
But every time he uses the word package, then somebody jumps on it, figuratively speaking.
Yeah, okay, I had a point here. What the fuck? Anyway.
You want to show the world your package is essentially your point.
No. My package is for me.
That's fine. It's cool. It's good to be proud of it.
So the point I was trying to make is when you have a comic book in your hands or a book or any sort of thing that you've bought and it's physical, you're looking at design from start to finish. You're looking at how it was bound, how it was lined up on the page, how it was printed. The quality of the printer, the quality of the inks that they use. Does the ink come off in your fingers? Do you get little black prints everywhere? Does the ink on the cover rub off? All of these things are part of the experience of the book that I think a lot of people are starting to disregard in favor of online stuff.
Same with music.
With music...
Like people are, you know, when you download MP3s or whatever, you don't have a physical case or something, a booklet to hold in your hand.
Well, let's be honest. The music industry whines and whinges and bitches about how they lost DVD sales and CD sales and all. But they've trained the public to disregard all the nice things about packaging. I mean, you look at what an LP had, the old style record, the large pictures,
nice,
the foldouts. You could pull it out. There were books inside of these things where you could fold out. Posters, you know, just beautiful, beautiful work back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s.
Yeah.
And they brought that down to CD, and if you trace the way CDs were, the books got thinner as time went on. They were giving less to you. I mean, you had some artists, Nine Inch Nails and Pearl Jam, I know, were pushing the boundaries on what you could do. I'm sure there were others out there.
Nine Inch Nails does have nice packaging.
Yeah, he's got a real nice eye for the artwork.
Yeah.
U2 on occasion would do something kind of nice with their books, but you know, they trained us to want less and less in that regard.
Less.
Exactly, to expect less. So when they switched over to digital and things became available digital, they'd already trained us not to want the rest of the stuff.
Yeah, at this
point. So they can complain, but it's their own damn fault.
At this point, I've got no interest in seeing what the artist looks like.
Lord knows, with celebrity magazines and Entertainment Tonight and all the other shows, you see it way too much anyway.
The music I listen to doesn't afford that kind of nonsense.
I can't escape it.
You'll never see Fetus on...
That's a good point.
On Spin Magazine or Rolling Stone. And there's something very nice about that. It's my music when I want it.
There is something to be said for anonymity. I mean, you go into a movie or you hear a song without the hype and the build-up behind it, and it has a hell of a lot more impact. Now, I was here in Japan before the movie websites really kicked in, and I saw The Matrix, and all I'd ever seen was one trailer for it, like the teaser trailer, and I went, okay, gotta watch that. But, you know, like, here in Japan, it's like a year and a half later when the movie actually comes out. And I just, you know, I just walked in not knowing what the hell it was. You know, it's sci-fi, I've got a little free money, let's watch this. And it just blew my mind. Mm. Same with Fight Club. Mm. No clue of anything about it. Somebody in the States. Somebody in the States wrote me and said, watch this movie, and said, hey, it just came out over here. Mm. Went in. It took me like a week to scrape up my brain. So there's something to be said for going into these things completely and utterly blind and unaware.
Yeah.
Which you don't get anymore with the way the internet has spread. At least not with the way that I obsessively read these movie and
I tend to avoid those things like on purpose so I don't get stuff spoiled.
They're addictive. They're horrible.
Yeah.
I can't stop looking.
No, I actually don't do that kind of stuff. And I avoid listening to movie podcasts unless I've seen the movie already.
It's a good idea.
Yeah, well, I mean, when I bring you a copy of a movie and you're just like, I'm like, all right, dude, it's a really good movie, and I won't tell you then. It's like, oh, I already know the ending. It's like, what's the point of watching the movie then?
I'm from the school that, you know, believes it's the way something's done rather than what's done. Because, I mean, half the time the story's been told like 1,000 times already. There are no new stories. I mean, the whole point behind somebody like Shakespeare... an English lit background. The whole point behind someone like Shakespeare wasn't that the story was new or different. Everybody knew how the stories ended.
Mm-hmm.
It was how he told it. It was the language that was used and how it was staged that was special. Which is why I don't have a problem with remakes of movies. It's why, if somebody wants to remake a film, go ahead. I have a problem with crappy remakes, what most of them are.
I have no problem with remakes either, but what I'm saying is some stories, you don't know exactly how it's going to go. Mm. You don't know which direction they're going to move it in.
I don't read the ending of a movie that I actually care about.
Okay, well for me, I like to let the movie unfold as it goes, and at the end, come to... Have you seen No Country for Old Men yet?
No, I haven't.
When you watch that one, it takes you by surprise in several places, not just the ending. And there's no way I will spoil this film for anyone. But to know the ending before you watch the film is really a shame. You deprive yourself of something there.
I don't know. Reading about an ending and actually experiencing the ending are different things for me.
Well,
if you're anticipating it, it colors it.
Hmm.
And I actually had to go back and watch it again just to get it through my system.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was hard for me to take, but once I understood it, I was like, that was awesome. That was really good.
Hmm.
And definitely. Don't read about it. Don't hear about it from anyone else. Just watch it and absorb it that way.
I think I've mentioned on podcast before how the big reveal of Return of the Jedi was spoiled for me.
The big reveal?
That Luke and Leia were brother and sister. That was a radio station that ruined it for me, but anyway.
But George Lucas ruins it for himself now that he's put 1, 2, and 3, and Padme's last words in number 3 are like Luke, Leia, and she names her kids and then dies.
If you watch the episodes in order, then
that's
a total spoiler. Yeah,
yeah.
What? Suddenly, there's no meaning to Luke. I am your father. So, yeah, okay, we knew that though. So
yeah, but he told it in this order for a particular reason.
For in what order?
He did four, five, six first because he wanted to keep it a surprise because he knew they were the stronger story and because the background story was something that was he was interested in. But
yeah, nobody would have been interested in episode 1 without 4, 5, and 6.
Right.
Well, had episode 1 actually made sense? Sure.
Now, I still defend the concepts behind episode 1, if not the movie itself.
To what end?
I thought episode 1 was a really interesting and brave way of filmmaking because everything important happens off-screen. Mm. Which, conceptually, works perfectly because the whole point is the cunning of Emperor Palpatine and the Sith, yeah. happens behind the Jedi's back. The whole point is that the Jedi are completely occupied with trivialities, and the important shit is going on, and they have no clue. Mm. Which is exactly what the movie is. The movie is, Lucas is showing you the trivialities that everybody's done, and he's hinting at all the political machinations and everything going on elsewhere, which is kind of why I like it conceptually.
Yeah, but he didn't...
But as a movie, it's not very interesting.
Yeah, he didn't... Well, no, not as a movie, it could be good, but he just didn't... He didn't deliver what he planned correctly. There's a lot of cutesy-cutesy stuff. There's a lot of... The movie is bogged down in the same details that the Jedi's are bogged down in. Mm-hmm. And so it winds up being a really boring thing.
That's why I say I like it conceptually, okay. if not the actual movie.
We've kind of strayed from the topic,
Okay, so as someone who is trying to start a comics career, which is the people we're aiming our podcast at, generally speaking, so if you could publish your comic online, which a lot of people do, and hopefully get it picked up by a publisher eventually, as some people do. And we were talking before we started recording about Mulele's Illustration Friday stuff. You put up the first picture on Illustration Friday, right? And then people come to your site to see the rest of each series.
It's not exactly the way Illustration Friday works. The way it works is they post a topic.
Oh, that's right.
And then you post a link to your own website.
With a thumbnail.
With a thumbnail, yeah. And the thumbnail at this point is just my my signature. Because it stands out in the lineup. Mm-hmm. But Illustration Friday, it's meant that you draw one illustration for the topic and that's it. And I was noticing in my hit counter that I would get a spike every day that I put a new illustration up. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want just one spike in the middle of the week. I wanted the entire week to be up. Mm-hmm. And so I started doing... I did my first series of five. Mm-hmm. Five pictures which made a story that fit the theme of that week, or the topic of that week, and it worked quite well. There's a really good response to it, so I decided to continue to do it, and it's starting to develop into something rather nice.
And I think the work fits Illustration Friday too, because it's not straightforward comic book. It works as individual illustrations too, which I think is the reason why that particular audience goes for it, whereas I think a lot of people's comics are not going to work that well. Mm-hmm.
Comics is so much more than what it could be. So much more than what we've got, and I don't mind playing with that. And I've played with it in other ways. Which I haven't published and can't really talk about yet.
I've seen the sketches for it. There is a lot of untapped potential there.
Oh, definitely.
Tons of it that sort of stretch the limits
of the medium.
There we go.
Yeah, the only thing really tired about American comics...
Spandex?
Well, yeah, are the stories that we're trying to pump into the audience. Mm. We're no longer trying to even give a fresh perspective. Mm. We're rehashing the perspectives at this point. Mm-hmm. And that's not good. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just can't stomach that shit anymore, which is why I groan every time I hear the word Marvel. it's not even that they make bad stories. It's just that there's nothing there that I haven't seen before. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Wolverine is gay.
But you gotta admit, he started out really cool. Like 20 years ago.
Yeah, when I was like 12.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, I mean, he was Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so Yeah, I don't know if we have anything more to say about this topic.
Well,
but
one last thing. So for the comic that I'm doing now, online, come to the website every, I guess it'd be Sunday afternoon.
Japan time, American time?
American time.
Sunday afternoon, American.
Japan time, Sunday, sometime after midnight, I put up the first picture, and it runs for the next 3 to 5 days. Mm-hmm. The length of the comic depends on the length of the need for the length of the story, but usually I try to max at 5, because to go over that would mean that I'm running 2 topics in 1 week. Someone emailed me and asked what I was going to do with all these stories, and I suggested either make prints or a book, and they opted for book. They want a book, so that's my plan. I'm going to make a book eventually. I don't know when or in what way or with what publisher or if I'm going to try and self-publish. Mm. Self-publishing is kind of a long, hard route.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I don't know if that'll happen this year, if it does have to go that way. Mm. But
yeah, you've got to handle the design, you've got to handle the layout, you've got to handle the printing problems and the color correcting and everything else. And it's a huge, huge undertaking.
Yeah.
It is a huge undertaking. But, I mean, this wouldn't be the first book that I've designed. Remember, I used to do this for Dark Horse.
Sure.
So, really, it's no skin. But
yeah, but you didn't have to deal with all the printing problems yourself. You'd hand it off to them, and then they'd deal with all the crap that follows afterwards. Now you'd have to deal with that, not to mention distribution, sales.
See, the only problem is just distribution. Now, aside from selling to fans, I mean, like, really hardcore fans who would come to my website and buy from me directly, also selling at comic cons and whatnot, and there's nowhere else for me to really sell it. And I push it through Diamond, try to go comic shop to comic shop. All of these things cost me shitloads of money.
Yeah.
So it's really a difficult sell for my own book. The only benefit that a publisher has for me, or I guess 2 benefits. Number one, they front the money. Number two, I'm using their distribution lines.
Yeah. Right, and the distribution lines are the big thing.
Yeah, they are. They are.
And the advertising. If they do it.
If they do it, yeah. Mm.
I think, to sort of wrap things up, I think we're just kind of starting to see publishers look into webcomics. It's sort of been assumed up until this point that if something's available for free, nobody's going to put out cash for it.
Mm-hmm.
But they're starting to see that might not be true, that people will buy something that's available online. And I think you're going to see more things picked up. In fact, it wouldn't surprise me if you see a giant trend happening, which completely burns it out for a little while, because that's what tends to happen in comics and movies and things. People... Every single webcomic and web thing is going to be a book, and you know, like 20 of them will sell and 10,000 of them won't, and then it'll die for about a year or two until it kind of reaches some sort of equilibrium, some sort of balance. But yeah, I think that we're just on the cusp of it.
Yeah, it begs the question though, why are we doing this? Why are publishers trying to go online?
To promote their material?
Well, to promote their material and to tap into a built-in audience. That's why they're picking up new people. People with webcomics.
It's larger than that, I think. And you're right, it is to tap into a new audience.
The create buzz type of thing.
We talked about this before, that print comics are dying.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people have known this for a while, but finally the publishers are starting to reach panic mode, where they'll try anything, give it away for free to see if it somehow boosts sales, because more people know about it. It's an odd concept, but don't give them a teaser of 6 pages, give them the whole fucking book.
Mm.
And then
DC was doing like half the book at a time. with, when something like Countdown was going on, they were putting up half of the, like half of the book until the book was, you know, until the next month, and then they'd put up the other half just to get you into the story so that you'd pick up the rest of them. They were doing that on MySpace. I don't know if it worked. I think the book sold pretty well, but
DC's already got the top numbers anyway, even though the top numbers don't. They're not great.
I thought Marvel used to have the top numbers.
No, they're usually Superman, Batman.
Yeah. Well, it's cool for Batman.
Yeah. Well, they've got...
Not that the man needs the money, being a billionaire and all, but...
Okay, so I guess we can maybe expect to see publishers doing more of this, either to promote the print books or give up the print books and just start doing online content and charging for some of it.
I think with publishers, you're also looking at the graphic novel outselling the monthly comic anyway.
Hmm.
You know, the
trade paperbacks.
The trade paperbacks. And I think that's very similar to this, because the comics that you're seeing, you know, when you look at Perry Bible or any of the online comics that get printed as books, they're printed as collections, as trade paperbacks.
Hmm.
And so it's almost the same thing, except that instead of putting out the monthly comic and having to suck up the printing fee, you're now putting it out online for free, and then you're printing it as a trade paperback, and so you only have to deal with the printing once.
Well, also the trade paperback has a shelf life, whereas a monthly has a shelf life of 1 month.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
I think that's probably one reason the Top Shelf steered Alex Robinson toward doing just graphic novels. Box Office Poison was floppies originally and then collected as a book, whereas then they said, well, with Tricked, why don't you just put out the book?
Yeah.
Skip doing the floppies.
Now, I mean, I love the floppies, but it wouldn't surprise me at all if they kind of go the way of the dodo.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I would be fine if the floppy went away. I think it would change the face of how people write. Mm-hmm. You're no longer... Because, I mean, with the comic that I'm doing now, I have a standard width.
Right.
But I have no standard height.
Right.
And the reason of this is because it's a blog.
Yeah,
you've got
so
as much space as you want.
Right.
Height-wise, you're not constrained.
And I plan to play with that because I know the dimensions of the screen that people view my website with. And so I can make them scroll down, and I can use it to my advantage in storytelling. It doesn't work that way in a book, but it's one of the advantages of having a blog.
Mm-hmm.
I can do that without having, like, they did it with that shitty comic that Frank Miller did, Batman and Robin the Boy Wonder, where they had the Batcave where it just folded out, and the Batcave goes on forever and ever and ever, and it just folded out for like 10 pages. It was really nice to look at. It was kind of a cute joke, but I'm just thinking of, okay, so this comic artist spent hours just drawing this big-ass picture for just a lame joke. That's just sad. But that aside, the concept is still there. You have space, but this time you have unlimited space.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. And with the trade paperback, you've got a little bit more... Well, I mean, with the blog, obviously, you've got unlimited space. Barring loading times, you know, download times. But
true,
with a trade
true.
Paperback, you've got... You can put a lot more money into a book like this than you can into a monthly floppy, which where you have a, you know, a standard size, and I know that some people, when they do their webcomics, they do it specifically to fit a certain size so that they can print it later, and other people kind of adapt it later on.
I have no idea how I'm going to adapt some of my size issues in a book form, but I mean that's half the adventure anyway. But I mean the web offers so much more than a floppy, and if the goal is trade paperback anyway, why don't you just not make them buy it twice, but just give it to them and give them something to cheer for.
I think that's pretty much the way we're seeing things going.
Deconstructing Comics is sponsored by ComicsNow.com. Get up to 30% off everything in stock, or join their subscription service and get 35% off with no minimum order. I have my comics delivered monthly, but you can choose to have them sent bi-weekly or weekly. For more information, contact them through the contact page at comicsnow.com. Many of the comics we review on this podcast are supplied by comicsnow.com, and they also provide Eric's newsletter featured on our site, globalcomics.net. Our theme song is performed by Firewater. We're always happy to critique your comics work here on our podcast. Hey, it saves us from having to find a topic. Send your work to podcast@globalcomics.net or write to me there and I'll give you the snail mail address. At frapper.com, you can put a pin in our Frapper map. There's a link to it from the podcast page at globalcomics.net. And help us get noticed. Give us a review in iTunes, Podcast Alley, Podcast Pickle, or podcast.com. We'd also appreciate your financial support. Send us a check and we'll tell you how to get rich running your own mail order business. But seriously, any donations we receive will be invested back into the show. You can send us a tip via PayPal from the link on the podcast page at globalcomics.net. And once again, the email address to submit your comic or send us any comments is podcast@globalcomics.net. Next week, we don't have a topic yet, but hey, you know it'll be good. So, till then, thanks for listening. This is Tim. See you next week on Deconstructing Comics.
So long, Superman. I'm taking a vacation. I'll miss your medication. It helped to ease the pain.